Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of I Don't Have All the Answers. And in this segment, you guys see me wearing my robe. So this is like a robe talk. It's gonna be a long one. So basically, whenever y'all see me in a robe, it's gonna be a long video, okay? And today we're talking about loving a narcissist, dating a narcissist. I've had my experience, and I'm gonna go ahead and first clarify that most people have narcissistic traits, but most people are not narcissists. To be a narcissist, there is a bit of psychosis, which I didn't even have the terminology for it. I didn't even have the word for it. I just knew that what I was seeing was crazy. What I was experiencing was crazy. And I was being made to feel crazy. So let me just get into the story. Some people, you know what, let me get some tea in my system. Okay, so for now we have water, and then until my tea is ready. But yeah, I wanted to first clarify, like, not everybody is a narcissist. There are people that are gonna have narcissistic traits, like I said before. So they may do some of the things that narcissists do, like gaslighting, manipulation. There's also abuse too, verbal or emotional type of abuse. But a narcissist is consistently doing and behaving in a way that is very detrimental to not only the person that they are harming, but themselves. And the reason that I say that there's a psychosis with it is because they don't even feel like they cannot recognize what they're doing. And if they do, they refuse to accept what they're doing. Whereas a regular person, when confronted with it, or if given the opportunity, they may actually shift and change because they actually do care. Narcissists don't actually care. All it is about control and how they feel. It doesn't matter what they're doing to the other person. Only thing that matters is how they feel. So, having said that, my experience with loving and dating a narcissist, you know, you never realize it at first. And if you do, that is a choice that one steps into, and it usually is one with regret. So they never display those, or it doesn't necessarily come forward as narcissism, because oftentimes they seem so confident and they seem so charming, and oftentimes they're very good looking. So you don't realize that all of this is because of insecurity. At the base of it, there is a deep insecurity with people that are narcissists. And with him, as everything began to just crumble, and like I was literally feeling the physical afflictions of his abuse. Well, and I'm gonna say that my ex-husband, he did warn me. He was like, he's gonna hurt you. And I wanted to be rebellious like I was when I was 19 and I ran off with my ex, you know? But I think I also knew that, yeah, even if he does hurt me, you know, I just didn't realize that that's what it was going to look like. I didn't realize that that's what it was going to be. And nonetheless, I learned and picked up so many lessons from the whole experience, which is why I'm sharing it. I share this story because, like I said before, my water boiled. So, as I stated before, every time I share these stories, and really the only reason that I share these stories is because I want them to serve as lessons. I want to shield other people from having to go through some of these experiences. And so, you know, having gone through some things and having lived through so many different experiences, but grateful to have gleaned the lessons, grateful to have taken the lessons from all those experiences, I share them here. Now, I also understand that some people have to just go through it for them to get it. And so, at least even if you don't necessarily, it doesn't resonate now, or you don't take anything from this, there may be little cues and little points that you can pick up to help you better interact with just people on a day-to-day basis. Because it's not just about romantic relationships. Narcissists can be friends, they can be family members. You just begin to pick up on so many things when you actually start to pay attention and you start connecting the dots and you listen, you know? So, yeah, that's why I share these stories. So, to get into it, I don't want this to be super long, honestly. So, I'm not gonna go, like, too crazy into it. I'm not gonna go too in-depth with it. There was one red flag, even before me getting into a relationship with him. And so I had the idea that there may have been someone else, but I believed when he said that there wasn't. And that was wishful thinking on my part. But when I did discover that there was someone else, I did break it off with him. But by that point, I was like so deep in, I was willing to continue the relationship with him. And so I was a side woman, I was a side piece, I was, oh my goodness, this is like painting a really bad track record for me, considering the previous video. But look, lessons learned, man. I had no experiences prior to, I mean, and it doesn't excuse anything. This is not an excuse for anything, but it's just to share perspective. I think that people, it's easy to judge folks when you have not been in that situation. I was one of those people that used to judge people and be like, how the hell this and how the hell that, when I had no life experience or no experience and never had been confronted with some of these things. So this has also given me compassion. This has provided me with perspective. So like I said, taking the lessons from this, there were red flags from the beginning. There were ways that he would make people feel uncomfortable. I didn't pay attention to that. There was a secretiveness. I didn't pay attention to that. There was a level of superiority that he carried that I was at first attracted to. I didn't pay attention that all of these things could turn and I would be the victim of these things. And I use victim, but like, I wasn't a victim. Within the first 6 months, all those signs had been there, but I was also telling myself like certain things, it just didn't make any sense. I remember my cousin's husband had said to me, he was like, yo, you've been stigmatized. And I was like, what the hell is that? I had never heard that term before. And he was like, yo, when you get in good pipe and you just start to act crazy, you start to do things that's not necessarily who you are. And I was just like, whatever, I'm just living my life, you know. I'm finally free and I'm just going to do whatever. What ended up happening is that as I just got deeper and deeper into this, why did I stay with him? I stayed with him for the same reason that I stayed married for so long, trying to prove a point. And at this point, it was trying to prove it to myself. And even though I was taking in all this pain, I continued to stay in it because I was like, this is what love is, right? Then that you bear the brunt of some of the things that the person that you love does. This is how you show that you love them. And he himself also believed that that's what love was, that I was supposed to continue to take what he was doing and accept it, and be okay with it because I'm supposed to have loved him. You know, I'm supposed to love him. And he learned that from his mom. His mom had to endure several, you know, children outside of the marriage. She had to endure so many different things from his father. And so he grew up witnessing this, you know, and even to the point where it did affect him, but he couldn't accept that it was now bleeding into his adulthood and it was ruining the path, his path, because he was making choices from a state of trauma. Like, he was just literally working and walking and living through his trauma. And he had multiple layers of trauma. It wasn't even just his childhood. He was also in the military, which another thing I also learned, that's like two guys I've dated from the military who all had like serious issues. So having taken that into account, this is what also provides me with perspective. It literally took me like a year and a half or a year to truly begin to heal and actually heal from that relationship. And it took me 3 years to just heal from all the things that I had experienced in my life up until that point. So the story where I was talking about the whole breaking of the generational curses, every single choice and decision that I was making once I broke up with him, you know, to really put myself first, was breaking those curses. And I was able to see the purpose that he served in my life. If it wasn't for him, I would have probably still been in an unhappy relationship. And if it wasn't for him, I would not have this doorway to which I now open to Black history, to my ancestry, to, granted, I always knew about my Haitian, you know, history, but he provided me with even more information that I didn't have access to, that I just didn't know. It was never told to me. And so I was also very much attracted to his mind because he educated himself a lot. But he did that because he wanted to feel superior. It wasn't so much that he utilized this to benefit his life and to better the world. It was just so that he can feel bigger than and greater than anybody and everyone else. And so when he wasn't doing what he needed, when he wasn't getting what he felt like he deserved, everybody else was to blame for it, and not the fact that he wasn't putting in the work and the effort to really do it. And he wasn't healing, and he wasn't a healed person. The first time that I recognized that there was something amiss, it was in play. Like, I literally just saw a shadow cross his face, his eyes. And I remember sharing this with a friend of mine. His eyes changed and shifted because I forgot what it was, but he thought that there was somebody else in the mix. I should have gone running from the hills at that point, but I didn't. And so I first saw that shadow then, you know, looking at the obvious things, the fact that he was, you know, having me as a side piece, and then he had this woman that was living with him who was his girlfriend, who moved down from a different state. And I found this out after we were already in intermingled for like 4 months. So at that point, I really felt strongly, you know, for him. But I was also holding on to something because I was going through such a tumultuous divorce, and I just felt the need to hold on to and grasp onto something that could satisfy me. The pleasure that I was receiving from my body, I was mistaking for a spiritual pleasure, and I was mistaking for love, and that's not what it was. And he took full advantage of that, but I gave it to him as well. I was giving a lot of myself to a person that didn't deserve it. And like I said, I really do take away the lessons from this, because I would not be able to talk about this in the way that I do. You know, honestly, there are sometimes people can talk about something, but you can't necessarily teach it and convey it in a way in which it makes sense. And for me, I love parallels, I love parables, and I love to illustrate something for it to be really understood and taken into account what is actually being dissected. I dissect my experiences. I dissect and analyze people. But I do that now. I wasn't doing it then because I was allowing myself to just experience this hurricane. All right, I went through a tumultuous season. And this is me being honest. He served a purpose in walking into my life, because he literally did walk into my life. And I still have fond memories because, and I can smile in saying this because I, like I said, I see the purpose in all of it. And I'm actually grateful. I didn't have to go through those experiences. Those were all choices that I made that made my experience that much more horrendous, made my experience that much longer. But I can appreciate where I am now. I don't live in the past. I don't live in regret. And I do not dwell on the negative things that have happened in my life. They serve a purpose. And even if that purpose was to my detriment and my harm, I'm taking the lesson and the positive from it because I'm no longer in that place. That is the true definition of healing. So that way, when I move forward, I'm not triggered by, and I'm not judging and looking at people based on what I've experienced. Now, it makes me a wiser person to be able to discern better as to who I can actually share space with and energy with. But I'm not judging people, and I'm not holding anybody else accountable for how I feel and the things that I go through, because I'm no longer putting myself in those positions. And should I find myself in that position, I am much better equipped to handle and deal with that. What he then began to do was just little by little, because he saw that I needed that attachment, he saw that what I was going through, goodness, he had a front row view of what I was going through with even my divorce. But him having that front row view also gave him information. And what it did was, thankfully, because of the choices, some of the choices that I was making, even in the breakup that I was going through, he saw that there were certain things that I was not willing to tolerate. And so his breaking down of me was gradual and it was slow. And by the time that I realized it, I was 2 years in, and I was just like, what is going on? Like, I didn't recognize who I was. I didn't like how I was feeling and who I was turning into. Never. You know, I told y'all I grew up watching Lifetime movies, you know what I'm saying? And so I was like, I'm turning into one of those women. I'm becoming one of those females. And even my good friend, who has my longest standing friendship, actually, You know, I was having, it was the last conversation in which I was like, I'm breaking this cycle. She was like, I don't like what this guy is doing to you. Like, I don't like this. I remember her expression. I remember the words. It was like, I don't recognize this person. Because everybody knows me to be a strong, headstrong, positive, you know, buoyant person. And my personality was shifting. You know, I opened the door for her to be able to see the pain and the hurt that I was going through because I trust her. So thankfully, I'm glad that she said that to me. I do appreciate honesty, yo, because that shit helps. And she started to dislike him as well because of what I was sharing with her and how I was like breaking down. People don't see me cry. Well, now. I'm okay with crying. But growing up, back then, people didn't see me cry. You know, she probably literally has only seen me cry a handful of times. And most of those times, it was because of him. The first time that she ever saw me cry, and I've known this girl since I was 9 years old. The first time that she ever saw me cry, and she didn't know what to do. I'm not going to go through the whole chronological timeline because I can't. So much stuff happened, and it would just take way too long. I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to try and pinpoint key things for you guys and how I got out and healed myself. But I remember, you know, in the real deep midst of the breakdown, when I began to realize that this person is really trying to tear me down. And I said to him, I'm like, yo, like, and my children were in the other room. And I was thinking of it before, and I finally, you know, said it to him. I'm like, you're trying to break me down, and I can't afford to be a broken woman. I'm raising two girls. This is not what I want them to think is normal. I left my other situation because I didn't want them to think that that was a healthy relationship when it wasn't. So for me to be a torn down person because of you, I can't do it. Like, I can't be a broken mother. I'm not gonna do that to my children. And you know, adamant, always like, no, I'm not, that's not what I'm trying to do. I'm not trying to break you down. And he would use like the quintessential tactics of a narcissist, you know. Then he was soft and, you know, loving. I'm not trying to break you down, you know. I just, you know, and it was always like, it was never enough. No matter what I did, no matter how much time I spent with him, no matter what I said, no matter anything, it was never enough. He just wanted more and more. And I couldn't give him more, quite frankly. You know, like, he started to complain about how much time we spent together. For me, I'm like, this is the only time that I have with my children. Then they gotta go to their dad. So, like, I don't know what more you want from me. I started to just bring it down because it was too much. And mind you, his living situation was not great. So it's not like I wanted to go over there. So I would tell him for him to come over, but he didn't want to do that either. That became a thing too. And so I was like, I can't, you know, I gotta be at home with my children. And he's like, I'm not telling you not to be with your kids. You know, I'm not telling you that. And I'm just like, well, you're not saying that in so many words. But if you're saying that we're not spending enough time together, and I'm already driving up here like 4 to 5 times a week, let make it make sense. Let's do the math here. He couldn't see that. And he began to just exhibit like the whole jealousy signs because I was trying to take back my power. I was trying to get back to who I was. And, you know, I was going out with friends. I get dolled up. Y'all be seeing how I be looking. You know what I'm saying? I look good. You know what I'm saying? So he started to get jealous. And at this point, I started to realize the insecurities in him. And at the point where it started to really go down and I started to see exactly what he was, which was a pitiful, insecure person, the jealousy that came out was just bizarre. And it affected a lot of my day-to-day life, and it affected my work. I had the amazing opportunity to meet Issa Rae, and he ruined, he assisted in ruining that encounter. And, you know, even my client who facilitated the meeting, she was like, you're not the same. Like, what happened? Because I was different until I had a phone call with him literally hours before she was coming on set. I have a phone call with him, and he picked a fight, accusing me of cheating on him because I was using a device that could record without me like holding the camera. And so he assumed someone else was holding the camera. And no matter what I told him and I showed him the device that I was using, which is a gimbal, I showed it to him, and he was like, no, you know, he didn't tell me you were traveling with anybody. And I'm like, I'm literally here by myself. Like, what are you talking about? I didn't travel with anyone. This guy cheated on every woman that he had ever been with, okay? So he was a projector. He projected a lot. And he was also a Capricorn. I'm a Capricorn. And one of the reasons why I don't like to, like, really identify with the zodiac signs, and especially when people feel like they're a kindred spirit because you have the same zodiac sign, this is part of that reason too, because he would liken himself to me because of our zodiac sign and be like, we're the same, you know? And I'm just like, nah, we're not the same. I don't do some of these things that you do. I don't treat people the way that you do. And I don't look at people. He was very cynical. Like, he was very cynical, an angry person, to be quite frank. And when he didn't get his way, he would lash out. And honestly, the only reason that he didn't hit me and beat me was because he knew that I would get his ass thrown in jail. He'd seen me call the cops before, and he knew I had no qualms with doing that. So he didn't want that kind of smoke. So he never actually laid his hands on me. Instead, he was just breaking me down emotionally and spiritually. And I say this because I felt it in my body, and I've never experienced anything like it again. I've never experienced that kind of a physical ailment and physical pain from emotional pain. I was emotionally tormented. Like, it got to the point where I would be laying in the bed next to this man crying.